Hi guys, whoop. Welcome. My name is Lee Boonstra. I work as a customer engineer for Google. And that means that I help in the pre-sales process customers with creating prototypes or answering questions about all our Google products. And I have a background in software development. So Google asked me like, hey Lee, do you want to give a talk about G Suite this year? I said, yes, but I like to give a technical talk. I love to talk about how you can extend on top of G Suite, whether it's in your own applications or whether you want to write code on top of G Suite. Because that is basically the idea on how, if you want to extend on it, there are two ways. You can take the app script approach. That means like, I stay within the Google domain, within a G Suite domain, and I write my own code on top of G Suite. That you can do that through AppScript. The other approach, that is through Google APIs. That is, I have my own application, and I host it somewhere, but I want to bring my data inside of my apps. I want to get everything from G Suite inside of my own applications, so to leverage the power of G Suite. So you probably would take one of these approaches. I'm curious, how many developers are here in the room? Few, or how many people read code once before? Yes, a little bit more, right? For the people that are not really into coding, but have great ideas on building applications, I will also cover AppMaker. That is our visual design editor, how you quickly can create applications basically by dragging and dropping, so with no code. And that's going to be interesting as well. But let's talk about AppScript first. What is AppScript? AppScript, it's basically JavaScript, but it runs on a server, serverless. That doesn't mean that there are no servers. No, there are servers arranged somewhere, but Google all takes care of that. And we just write JavaScript code as if it was in a browser, but just keep in mind it runs somewhere on a Google server. And together with that, it also has like all these nice APIs, these Google APIs and services that are all available within your AppScript environment. Now, and with that, you can create your own add-ons or extensions or themes. And the big advantage here is that once you do that through AppScript, you no longer need to deal with OAuth. That has all been taken care of you. And OAuth, that is a way how you can secure your applications. The developers here probably will understand, like, yeah, to set that up, that could be difficult. But yeah, this has all been arranged in the environment from G Suite, so that is nice. And with that, you also get a lot of other tools like monitoring tools and logging. And then once you have your add-on finished, yeah, you can drop it in the marketplace or in the Chrome Web Store, or you can have it internally being shared. There are, in general, four different entry points in if you want to write AppScript code, where would you start? And I think the most common one that will be like, I have a document or a sheet, and I want to write scripts for that particular document or particular sheet. So there is like a relation between your code and that sheet. We call that container-bound scripts. So that it's one document or one sheet together bundled with your code. And to talk to that code, what you would first do in your code, you would say like document app and then get active document or get active spreadsheet. So you have a reference to that active tab or active sheet, and then you can start coding on it. You would write some triggers. You say like every time when I open this document, I execute this piece of code, or every time I edit this this document, I run some secret code in the background. That's how you have to set that up. Now, the other entry point that will be like, it's not bound to a particular document or sheet. In this case, you would create, like you would create a normal web application, but with AppScript. So you would go to script.google.com, or you go to your Google Drive. And from there, you open the AppScript native editor. And then you start coding your scripts over there. And what typically what people do is then when you execute, when you run such a piece of code, then they show a file picker, and the user can select the sheet or document that they need, and then you can start executing the code. That way it's more reusable. Now there's another entry point that is more like AdWords. It's like in case you're doing stuff with advertising, you can also code AppScript code, so JavaScript code, which runs on the server, but it's particular for AdWords. And the last one, although AppMaker in general, you don't necessarily need to code. You could code if you want. And yeah, then you have the choice between normal JavaScript code or also AppScript. And then, again, it runs on the server. We will talk about this later. So how would I write AppScript code? I'll show you like a simple demo on how you could do that. But first, as a developer, what I would do is I would read the manual. So I go to the docs page from Google. There they really explain it pretty well, like all the API methods that are available and that you can start using. If it's for a container-bound script or if it's for your own web applications, it's all available there. And that's definitely the starting point where you would start. In this case, I went to the Google Drive. I start opening my native editor, Google Apps Script. I could also go to script.google.com. And what I'm going to create in this example is a kind of conference application where speakers can upload their presentation. And every time when a presentation was uploaded, I will get an email to ask me if I can approve the presentations and can read through it. I think this is a very simple application, but a use case that I think everybody could create. So what you would do here in this case is you would go to their Google Drive, you would create a folder, and you need to share that folder because then all the other speakers can upload their presentation in there. And when you do that, you get an ID. And that is an ID that you need to copy because this is the ID that we will refer to in our code. So in our native editor, we will create a variable called slides folder ID, and then I paste the code that I just copied in there. And then I start writing JavaScript code. It's very easy. In this case, I create a variable folder, and I say like drive application, get folder by ID, and I take the ID that I just copied. The next thing is I want to retrieve all the files that are in that folder, so I can do that with folder.getFiles. And the next thing on line 6, what I'm doing here is I create a kind of store. So what I'm want to do is I want to create some kind of persistence layer here. It's just simple storage that every time when I next week, if I open this script, that it still has some way of storing which files are new and which files are old. So it's a kind of key value store that it's very simple. So that's what I'm creating here. The next thing is I create a variable new files. This is just for flagging if the file is new. And then I will loop through all the files, the file iterator that I created before. And I check if the file is new. And if the file is new, then I'm going to add it to the new files array. So then I can do something with that later. And I will also add it to the persistent layer so that next week when I run this script, then that the new file won't show up again. And the last piece of the code, in this case, I check like, oh, are there any new files? Well, yes, there are. OK, I'm going to lock them. I'm using basic locking here. And I'll send an email. And the email that's done through the email API. So I can say gmailapp.sendemail. What am I sending? I send an email to the active user, which is me, and I retrieve file get name and file get URL. So that is what I push in the email. And then I can start testing it. So I would press the play button here. At that moment, I will probably see a log message. So you can go to your basic logging, so view logs. And then you would see a log message like what you see on the top screen. But if you want to have it more advanced, it is possible to use Stackdriver here, and then you would use console.log. And then once it's in Stackdriver, you have much nicer, richer stack traces and better logging. So that's an option for you. This is the email, how it would look like when I retrieve that email. Now, that was just a test. How can I bring that to production? Well, I need to set up some project triggers in this case. That means like I'm going to schedule it that every time it will run. When I create my first time the project triggers, there aren't any. So I need to go to this process. This also means that I need to be authenticated. I need to authorize myself that I'm allowed to open the drive box and also the email. So I reveal the permissions. You get like a nice all-out pop-up, and you allow that pop-up. You can see also I need read and send and delete access for Gmail. That doesn't necessarily need to be the case because I'm only sending an email, but definitely for if you want to read email from your Gmail account, then you need to approve on that. And I also need to give access to the drive. Then I set the trigger, and in this case, I create a time-driven trigger for 5 minutes, and every 5 minutes, it starts running the script, and then it sees if there are new files in, and sent me an email if there are any. This all runs on the Google server. There are a couple of things on the roadmap for AppScript and add-ons in general, and one of these things is Gmail add-ons, which is something I like because now we can probably create a kind of templates in Gmail that you can automatically send reports or so. Slides will also get add-ons feature. I use a lot of slides as I do a lot of these kind of talks, so I'm very happy with that. That is actually an early access program, so if you want, you can try this out. Just register for that. And also mobile add-ons. So if you create AppScript for Docs or Sheets, then it will also work on your mobile phone. That works through your mobile phone via the browser, but on native, also on Android. Yes. Now let's take a look into the second approach. That will be the Google APIs. Google supports like many, many languages, if not all. All the popular ones. Think about Node.js or JavaScript, Java, .NET, Ruby, also for mobile, Go language. Google has all client SDKs for all these languages, and you can just start downloading such an SDK and then implement that in your own web application. So in this case, what we're going to do is we're going to integrate G Suite in our own applications. Through such an API, such a client SDK, you get all the endpoints, and with that you can retrieve access to the Google Drive or to your Sheets. So let me show you an example of that. I created a simple application myself like the other week where I wanted to create, for my Google Home, I wanted to make sure that Google Home would read up all my emails. And the way how I wanted to do that is by putting all my email headers in a sheet and then asked Google Home to read up the sheet. So I created that with Node.js because I'm a JavaScript developer. So I went to NPM, I downloaded the package. The next thing is in my Google Cloud, I go to the Gmail API and I need to enable APIs. So every API that you want to use, you need to make sure that you first enable it. And at that moment, you can also monitor it and see like the amount of users that has been used through your API. And you can secure it so not secretly other people can start using the API. So it's really all secure within with the OAuth from Google. You set up your credentials. What I did is I created a JSON file, a JSON credentials key, a service account, we call that. And I put that in my folder structure. And that service account contains all the information of connecting to my account. I need to set that up and whitelist that. Then I need to start looking into OAuth too. That can be tricky, but luckily the SDKs, they have support for that, so you can start using the predefined code from Google. And that is what I did in this case. I created first, I generated a URL that the SDK did that for me. With that URL, I can log into my own Google account. So at that moment, it knows that it's about me and that I give access to certain files or folders. I get redirected to a different page, and I get a new code. And with that code, I create an alternate object, which will be a bearer token. And what I did is I saved that in my folder structure so that the next time I don't need to go through this whole process again when I'm on localhost. Now then the code. Code is not so difficult either. I started by implementing the packages. So I say I require the Google APIs and I require the Google Auth library. So I don't need to do all the OAuth stuff myself. I can just copy paste that, which is the authorize to get new token and the store token functions. I need to define scopes. Now in this case, I want to get access to Gmail.
So I set the scope for that, and I also create the folder where I, or I point to the folder where I save the service token on my hard drive. So then Node.js can figure that out. And this is the actual code that I wrote myself by looking into the documentations. I say gmail.users, messages list. So I want to retrieve all the emails that are in my inbox. And in this case, I query on unread. So these are new messages that are coming in my email box. If it went wrong, because this is a callback, what you see here. If it went wrong, it shows me an error message in Stackdriver. If it went fine, then it gets into here. And then I save the emails in variable emails. This will be an array with IDs. You probably choose such an ID, you want to retrieve the body of the email and the subject. So then you would say gmail.users.message.get, and then you query on the ID that you just retrieved. And at that moment, then you have all the emails, and I would put it in my, I would make another call to access my spreadsheet and save it in there. Now, there are many APIs like these that you can start using for Google Drive, for Calendar, Gmail, you name it, almost every Google project has an own API that you can start using and playing around with. Definitely, if you're a developer, I would definitely look into it, because like Google made so much nice things for you that you can very easily just start using. So pretty awesome. And the next thing that I like to look into, that is AppMaker. And maybe you've seen it in the keynote earlier today. This is our visual drag and drop design editor. You can create applications, but you don't necessarily need to code. And I will show you that also in my demo. I will show a to-do application that I created within 5 minutes with no coding, just dragging and dropping. Yeah, so it's powerful apps for your business. The key benefits in this case is that you can create applications very fast. It's all integrated within G Suite, so you can make use of all the G Suite APIs, the Google APIs. You can also make use of the Google Cloud Platform components. So for example, if you want to store your data in a Cloud SQL, you can easily just connect to that and set that up. Data binding, so once you have like your data in your application, you can very easily just bind it to a widget, and you will see it on the page. And the last thing, everything is compliant and secure. Because it's in the Google domain, it's all secured, and nobody else can get there. That also means that you're building applications for a domain and not really for an app store. This answers the question that a lot of companies and developers had, where enterprises want to create applications. Even at Google, we have lots of business problems that we want to solve. And you can ask a developer to code it, and then it will take maybe a month. But how nice would it be if you can just create it yourself very easily by prototyping it, or you can create a production version within a few days? Think about dashboards, asset trackers, HR programs, stuff like that. This is very, very essential, and everybody could start using it. It's a SaaS application. It runs in your browser, and everybody with a G Suite business account can easily just log in and start playing around with it. It's based on open standards. So HTML, JavaScript, CSS. It also works nice on mobile. So you get like the material design look and feel. So that runs nice on a tablet, runs also nice on a desktop. You don't need to be a software developer in this case. So instead of talking about it, let me show you a demo that I created on how you can create an application. It's a semi-live demo, I have to say, because I recorded it, because I was afraid, like, what if we would a bit over time, then it's probably better if I just show a video. So I will go through the video with you, and I will stop, pause it. What you see here is the app maker, the default screen. You start by setting up a project, and then the first thing what you would typically would do is you would create a model. And a model that is like describing an entity. And an entity, for example, could be a car. A car has a brand, a car has a color, has a number of wheels, all properties, from a certain type that you need to define, and then you bind it to some data source, some database to retrieve all that data. And that is what we're going to do here. By default, it will select the Google Drive table. That means that the persistence layer will be in the Google Drive. We're going to save all the data in Google Drive. But there are other ways what you could do as well. For example, you could store it in Cloud SQL, or you could store it in a directory. That's all. You can just select it. In this case, I'm just creating my own model, and I want to save it in the Google Drive. I'm not doing anything difficult here. So I create, and this will be a to-do application. So I give the model name, the name tasks, and I'm going to create some fields for the task model. If I want, I could retrieve fields via a CSV file, maybe a database export, and you want to retrieve all the fields. Or what I'm doing here, I'm creating them manually. So I create a field task name, and task name will be a string. And that will be to save the name of the task. The next thing that I will do is I will create a field called task date, right, to mark when the task was created. That will be of the type date. And I can just select that. And the last one that I will do is I will create a field called completed, which will be a Boolean type, to flag if I completed the task, yes or no, true or false. Well. All right. Now I'm done with the model. I could connect at this point to databases and stuff, but I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to create a very simple application. I create some pages here. For my application, I need two pages. One is the main screen that will contain all the components. And then I will create a second page, which is the add screen. That will be a pop-up with a floating form where I can create new to-dos, and then it will be shown on the main screen. So that is what I'm doing here. I create a second page, and I will give it the name add. There you go. It's important how you name it, because this is also where you reference it later. This is how AppMaker will know that. Okay, but what you see me doing here is I clicked on the widget button, and I can select a widget. So I can choose from forms or tables or buttons. All types of components are there. And in this case, I selected the table component. And what it does, it automatically recognizes my model. I created the tasks model before, so it will already highlight that. I can create this table now here. And what is really nice is through data binding, and because it knows it's a task model, it will automatically create all the columns for me in the grid. So it knows exactly like, oh, you need a task name, and that's a string, so we sort it on alphabetical order, while the date needs to be sorted on a date. It's possible also to enable paging. There are all just options that you see here on the options screen. What I'm doing here is I just do some resizing. I position the grid nicely on the screen. I'll just put it in the top. And I also give it a nice width. I wanted to make sure that this one runs on a phone. And I knew that I was testing it on a laptop. So after I'm done with that, I will drag another component on the stage. And in this case, it will be a form. I'm going to create an edit form or a read form. So every time when you select a task, then it will show that in this form. And again, it recognized the model. So I said, like, OK, take the task model. Through data binding, every time when I select a task, you'll see the task in the edit screen. And it does that for me out of the box. So I just drag that form inside of the on the stage. Again, I will do some resizing to make sure that it's nicely aligned. After I'm done with that, I'm going to create an add button so that I can open the pop-up screen to add new components. So I drag a button there, and then when I select it, I can give it a name. This is the name of the button if I want to refer to it in code. And I give it a text, so then you see how it looks like on the screen. Oh, yep. That went a bit fast. Once I'm done with that, if you can click on the on click menu here. And then you say like, okay, what will happen when I select it? Oh, in this case, I will open the ad screen. And then, yeah, you can design the ad screen there. It looks like I'm missing a minute, so I'll talk you through. So after you designed the ad screen as well, and then you can hit the preview button. That is what I did here. And now you see the application running in the browser. I can create a task. This is the pop-up. I give it just a title, just some data, and a task date. You see, you get the nice date component. I submit it. And once it's there, I can select it. And then I can also flag it as completed. And once I completed it, you see that it's also completed in the top. Right. OK. So what you've seen is I didn't use any coding here. It was just dragging and dropping. But if I wanted to make it more advanced, I could use some coding. You just need some JavaScript knowledge for that. That can be JavaScript on the client in the browser. So then you just write normal JavaScript code. Or it can be app script code. But you add that code in the app script itself. And automatically, you make use of all the Google APIs. And yeah, you can start playing around with that. Yes. So App Maker, that will be available in Q4. If you want, you can start playing around with it. You need to be a G Suite Business customer. And you can go to this page, and you can whitelist yourself so you can start playing around with it. I definitely would advise you to play around with it, because it's so easy to create an application nowadays. And with that, I'd like to hand it over to Leo Koster from Foxy, who has a very business application created, and he likes to talk about that. Thank you.
Thank you, Lee. Hi, I'm Leo Koster. I own an enterprise software company that is successful in business since 1987. And we were one of the first in Holland to be available on the internet online in 2001. But I wasn't happy. Some 3 years ago, I realized that we were not moving fast enough, not innovating hard enough, not preparing ourselves for future challenges. And I asked myself, what is happening? The world is changing, and software is eating the world. It's about new customers asking me questions I couldn't answer. And I saw a new type of employees coming that were switching from software their boss taught them to use to software they love using. And that became our new mission, to create software for the business user that they love. And to be able to deliver on that promise, we had to create something completely new from scratch, and that is Foxy. Foxy solves one problem. Let me give you an example. You're an IT services company, and you're successful, and you're growing. The first thing you put into place is something on the back end for a financial solution to take care of your invoicing and cash collection. And then you go over to putting something into place to attract customers and keep them. Outbound, inbound marketing. But in the middle, it's chaos. It's a combination of different app, custom solutions, paper, you name it. Foxy turns this into a smooth and efficient process. Why business apps? Let me introduce to you Willem. Willem Loos, founder and CEO of one of our launching customers. Willem's job is to produce one of Holland's most famous export products, parties. They started out by producing the shows of DJ Tiësto. Now they're producing big corporate events worldwide. And with every event, they produce tons of information. Project planning, resource planning, rigging planning, sound planning, light planning, sketches, detailed schemas, massive amounts of data. And they share this with hundreds of people. Temporary employees, customers, contractors, subcontractors, everybody. Everybody is connected and working together, collaborating on G Suite. And G Suite enabled Willem to grow even further. But Willem was missing something. Willem came to us with a question. Why can't I find a business app that is integrating all that information from G Suite into something I can look at my phone? Why? Because when Willem is producing his events worldwide, this is his office, a taxi, and in this case, a taxi in Tokyo. The backseat of the taxi is his office, and he wants to be able to sit there and have a look at his phone and to see whether his projects are on track, his people productive, his invoices going out, and the money coming in. And of course, we told him, look no further, we have Foxy. What is Foxy? Foxy is a vertical solution for a very specific market. It's for professional services. That's for everybody who is delivering services through projects with highly skilled professionals on the move. What sets Foxy apart? That's three things. The first one, it's a social user experience. We've taken the best examples of social media to the business space. We've taken the timeline, the activity stream, to the business user. And how's that helping? Because then nobody has to ask anymore, where can I find it? The most commonly asked question with business users. And we have an avatar with Foxy, that's Victor, who's helping you through the day. Mobile first, that's obvious, because in a couple of years, there won't be any more mobile first, it will be mobile only. And the third one is a no-brainer, because Google Cloud will be the dominant platform with next generations. Who is using Foxy? The account manager, responsible for the customer, the project manager, responsible for the projects, the professional, the engineer, consultant, developer, doing the actual job, the manager, and the support staff in the back office. And how are they working together in this quote-to-cash process? It goes like that. It starts with the account manager creating the quote. Then it goes through the organization, and it's a pretty straightforward process. It's expensive in purchase invoices, invoices going out. And, oh, let me go back. Oh, I'm too fast here. Let me, and then if you do this a multitude of times, then perhaps it can be handy to have a manager around to have some overview. And the crucial thing here is the handovers. I need to have my information at exactly the right time to do my job. It's the handover between all those personas, those roles in professional services. And Foxy turns this into a smooth, speedy, and efficient process. And how did we do that? How did we develop Foxy? When we knew we had to start from scratch, I started looking at what other successful software companies were doing. And they were making use of other people's hard work. They were using platforms, platforms as a service. And I made an inventory of all the available platforms. And for me, the most innovative, the most fun, the most technologically advanced was the Google Cloud Platform. And it gave me all the possibilities to create something beautiful. And we formulated some starting points. Do as little as possible. Use what is available, because you want to be able to put a minimum viable product out on the market with as little effort as possible and as soon as possible. Use everything by Google, managed by Google. We are developers, so even DevOps is difficult for us. We want to develop, no ops. Oh, sorry. Let's go back. So, building something new for this connected world makes only sense if you have a global ambition. So scale is important. Design for scalability. And for the business user, security is of paramount importance. And with Google Cloud Platform and working together with G Suite, we get that security. Being on the Google Cloud Platform allows us to have a very clean and simple architecture, and we love clean and simple. We have Angular on the front end, Python on the back end, all managed by Google on App Engine, and the data is stored in the Cloud Data Store. Nothing more. Simple. And in our pursuit of no ops, we use some other Google products. Our continuous deployment is fully automated with Jenkins on Compute Engine. We monitor Foxy by using Google Analytics and the combination of Stackdriver and BigQuery. And we slice and dice the information with streaming the data to BigQuery and analyzing it with Data Studio. Here are some examples of the integration with G Suite. The first one, it's user management, identity management. Every user, especially the business user, hates logging on, signing in, especially if they have to sign in to different applications to complete one job. And we've taken care of that by using the Google account. It's a matter of signing in, choose the right account, and you're done. Another example is storing data. Everybody knows how difficult it is to get users to store the data with the right projects, right customers, right opportunities. We've provided them with this little icon, this little button here, and you click it and you go exactly to the right folder, all managed through the right APIs. Everybody knows that account managers love to copy old quotes and edit them, copy and paste. And I'm not going into details about all the problems that it's creating. So we've made it easy for them to just click one button, create a new quote, and it is created with the right template, the right settings, in the right folder, and it's ready there for them to edit. This is one of my favorites, sending out the quote. I get notified on my timeline that it's time for me to send out this quote. Somebody else approved it. I click on the button, and it's gone. Entering data. Also some fun point. Nobody likes to enter data anymore. And why should you? You're on Google, so you have to find information. Here, I'm creating a new organization with a contact person. I'm looking up the right organization through the Google Places API, select it, select the right contact through Plus API, and when I've entered them, the result is a card filled with the contact information, the right pictures, logos, I'm done. Management and support staff, they love sheets for reporting. So we created a bunch of sheets for them. And here you have a financial example. Table sheets, easy to use. And we've developed our own add-on with AppScript to refresh the data into that report. And last but not least, installing Foxy through G Suite Marketplace. We're using that API to get Foxy, to get Foxy into, Foxy into your own domain with all the right settings for the right users. That was the last example. Curious about Foxy? We have a booth there in the main hall. If you have any questions, please ask us.
Thank you, Leo. Thank you, Leo. It's pretty impressive, that application. So definitely visit the Foxy booth. So now you have seen like there are various ways in how you can create applications. You can do that through AppScript. You can do that with your own code base and just integrate the Google APIs inside of that. Or you can use AppMaker. And with that, I would like to thank you for being here and wish you a very great day. And I don't want to keep you up from lunch, so thank you so very much.